In the headlines, local ham radio operators link Dominicans with their loved ones in the aftermath of Hurricane Irma. Dominicans want to not let their guards down with Hurricane Jose continuing to strengthen in the Atlantic. And the DPSU leadership tells fellow trade unions to stop dragging their feet on forming a trade union congress. I am Andrea Louis with the Channel 5 News. Back with the details after this. Thank you for staying with us. First up, people desperate to get in touch with their loved ones in Irma-affected countries have a medium to do so through the Dominica Amateur Radio Club, Inc.
The communication will be facilitated by ham radio operators. President of the Dominica Amateur Radio Club, Inc., Joseph Raymond, says they work closely with the Office of Disaster Management.
They would get in touch with the National Disaster Agency in their country, and so they would be able to share information. When disaster strikes, persons would report to the disaster office, or the disaster office would have teams of persons who would go out into the communities to find out what is the situation. And so through the disaster office, they would get in touch with the ham operator in whatever country that's affected, and the ham operator will be able to talk to other hams in the other islands. And so that's how we would pass information, whether it's on voice or digital mode. That's how we do it.
People can request information about their relatives through WhatsApp numbers 225-4428 and 613-7328. Raymond says they have already established contact with Anguilla and St. Kitts. His last contact in Turks and Caicos this morning informed him that they were preparing for the hit.
From yesterday, I've been getting calls and WhatsApp messages from a few friends in Dominica who were very much concerned about their relatives in Anguilla and St. Martin and St. Thomas. I myself have relatives in these parts of the Caribbean, and Montserrat also. And so persons have been calling me. And so in the Caribbean, we have what we call the Antilles Emergency and Weather Net, where ham operators meet on a daily basis, twice a day, to share messages, weather information. And so when a ham comes up from a country that is affected, he would basically give us information as to what the situation is in their country. So the persons who have been contacting me, I am collecting the information, and so at the appropriate time, I would call or speak to persons in the affected area and to pass on the messages. And so last night, I was able to contact a ham operator in Anguilla, that is, his call sign is Victor Papa 2 Echo India Hotel. And he said he gave us a report as to the situation on the ground. Many houses damaged and some persons are displaced, homeless. And so at the time that we spoke, there were no reports of casualties. But we gave him information so that he could pass on. And so we're hoping that we'll get a feedback as to the persons that we requested to look out for, whether they're okay.
Ham operators are trained in emergency radio communications.
Right now in Dominica, we have presently a few ham operators who have high frequency capabilities. We have Wayne Ibrahim in Portsmouth. We have John Christian in Mount Prosper. We have Clement James in Goodwill. You have Joseph Gist in Castlebrooks. You have Anthony Gordon, who is based in Castle Comfort. And myself, I'm based in Roseau.
Moving on to the fishing sector, fishermen around the island have been warned to adhere to their advisories despite the economic blow to their pockets. The word from officials of the Fisheries Division as the country is on high alert for Hurricane Jose. Earlier this week, Dominica was on guard for Hurricane Irma, and the fishermen were asked to secure their boats and gear and refrain from venturing out to sea since Monday. A small craft advisory remains in effect for the island as the region braces for the effects of Hurricane Jose, and Senior Fisheries Officer Norman Norris is asking fishermen to take the advisories seriously.
Most or almost all fishermen are self-employed, and this is really the biggest challenge for them. If they don't work, they don't get paid. So with boats being there on shore, it is difficult for them. And actually, one guy out there in the yard told me he was going out this morning, and he will come back and put his boat up in the afternoon because their livelihoods have been affected. And even before I say that, I want to compliment them and thank them for listening to the advisory of ODM and the Fisheries Division. With Jose coming, we have actually asked them, it's better to just keep the boats in shore and wait until the storm is over. But from what I'm telling you now, some fishers actually said that they want to take the chance to go out because they need some sum of income to purchase some supplies and be able to continue their regular livelihood.
Despite the fishermen being advised to stay on land, there has not been a shortage of fish for consumption on the island.
I was out last week. I was out at Anstime and Marigot and Kalibishi and in Ton and Mahu. There was a very big supply of fish. All of those facilities had a lot of fish, and this, I don't know if it's it really has to do with the FADs, the fish aggregation devices. So fish is always something in abundance. The challenge really is the location. You know, some places have a lot and other places don't have so much, but so, the distribution. So we try to create some balance with that by ensuring that at least the places that have low supply, they have access to cheap quality fish.
Norris is warning fishermen that no value can be placed on their lives and they should be responsible in their actions, especially for their families and dependents.
Anybody who takes that chance, it's really at their own risk. And it's not just the alone, but their dependents, the families, the kids, and concerned persons. So again, we want to appeal to fishers in the situation right now where we have Jose coming in. It's better to take the precautionary approach and to keep the boats on shore. All persons will understand that it's high risk and you cannot afford to lose any of your equipment or your assets that are your survival for your business.
Jose is expected to start affecting the region on Friday. Heading out to the region where Antigua's Prime Minister, Gaston Brown, has described the impact of Hurricane Irma on Barbuda as unprecedented. So far, there's been one confirmed death. Cell phone towers are down and access to the island is only by helicopter. Prime Minister Brown told CNN that the island is barely habitable.
Could describe the scene you saw over Barbuda today?
It was heart-wrenching, absolutely devastating. I have never seen any such destruction on a per capita basis compared to what I saw in Barbuda this afternoon. 95% of the properties in Barbuda were damaged. The infrastructure was damaged, all of the institutions, the lone hospital, the schools. It is absolutely heart-wrenching.
You said 95% of the structures are damaged. How many of those are completely destroyed?
In my estimation, probably about 20%, 30% of the properties were totally demolished. And let me add here, too, that even the Lone Airport as well was damaged, so it cannot accommodate any form of flights. So the only way to access them now is via helicopters. We have a situation, too, in which the telecommunication system was totally destroyed. So, for example, we have seen cell towers literally broken in two.
So is the island right now cut off?
Well, it was, and that is why it took us so long, because we could not have gotten any form of communication. They had a ham system there that was actually ham radio system. It was destroyed. They even had a few satellite phones, and apparently those got damaged during the storm. So they had absolutely no mechanism to communicate with us. It was too treacherous for any boats to go over to Barbuda, and even for helicopters. But a few of us journeyed over there this afternoon. We actually risked the elements in order to get an idea as to what was happening, because we noticed that after about 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. Last night or this morning, we could not have gotten any form of communication from Barbuda.
You know, in some of the video from today, we can see the cell tower seems just snapped. In terms of injuries or fatalities, what have you learned?
Well, luckily, there was only one fatality. I'm told that apparently one of the properties that was destroyed, the mother was actually moving the child, and obviously they were trying to get to safer ground. And during the process of leaving the property that was damaged, apparently the child suffered a fatal injury. But when you look at the extent of the devastation, I'm surprised that we did not have any more fatalities. So that in itself would have confirmed that, they would have had a high level of preparedness. But the monstrosity that this storm was anything that would have been in its path evidently would have suffered the wrath of that storm. So it is easily one of the most consequential storms to have actually developed in the Atlantic, and certainly to have actually stormed through the Caribbean.
60% of the population on Barbuda is now homeless. This is due, of course, to the destruction caused when Hurricane Irma barreled into the small island, packing winds of 185 miles per hour, killing at least one person. Prime Minister Gaston Brown says a significant amount of resources will be required to rebuild Barbuda.
The good thing about it is that we had already made some contingency plans. I have to admit that at one point we thought that they may not have been necessary. We did not cancel them. We have actually delayed some of them because we weren't too sure of the extent of the damage in Barbuda. It means now that we will activate those mechanisms. So tomorrow we have about two cargo planes full of supplies that will be landing here in Antigua. We had asked the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela to assist us in providing two cargo planes, two military planes to move some building material probably out of Panama. So we will now pursue those options and to make sure that we can move building material into Barbuda as quickly as possible to start the rebuilding process. We never really anticipated this level of damage. I have to admit the standby overdraft facilities that we had from the domestic banks will make what is required here in terms of the amount of funds absolutely pale. I mean, the amount that they have offered, and we are very grateful, the extent of damage or damages will make that financial assistance pale, which means that we have to raise external resources to supplement our domestic resources in order to have a serious push to rebuild Barbuda.
The people of Barbuda have been commenting on the superstorm's impact on their homeland.
Nacinta Ned, chairlady of the Barbuda Council. Where to begin? Where to start? This is just one word, epic. What we experienced is like something you see in a horror movie. It's something that you watch on TV, but not something you expect to actually happen in reality. I mean, persons were literally running from house to house, and we had cars flying over our heads. We had containers, 40-foot containers, flying left and right. And the story that you're getting from most of the residents here is that the eye of the storm came just in time. Persons were literally tying themselves to their roofs with ropes to keep them down.
My name is Rhoda. I grew up in Barbuda. I witnessed Hurricane Lewis, and compared to that, this has been something that I've never imagined experiencing. It was horrible, it was devastating, it was sad, and it was tragic. And to see and hear everything that happened, being in the middle of it, being here, it's the most horrible thing that could happen here or anywhere else in the world.
My name is King Goldilocks. Last night was the most devastating experience I ever had in my life. And I am almost 60. I witnessed Hurricane Lewis, but it was never like this. This one is the worst and the most devastated, done more damage to Barbuda than any other storm that we in our lifetime have experienced. This storm came and did some damage to Barbuda. Really, almost 90% of the houses in Barbuda who don't lose the roof, the house crumbled. Some people totally lost. Like me, I am homeless.
I'm Henrietta Hopkins, and I had a terrible experience last night. I don't wish this on nobody's life, and I don't want to see next hurricane like this. Because when I was in the house was boarded up, and something still come and bust the window, bust the bed in two, and we had to close the door, and it burst off the bedroom door too, so we had to leave at that place and go to our next house.
Barbuda is reported to have a population of roughly 1,400. Still in the region, Hurricane Irma has seriously impacted the U.S. Virgin Islands, affecting homes and, according to USA Today, crippling the only hospital on St. Thomas. There have been reports of houses slamming into other houses, causing serious devastation. We are told winds from Irma ripped off the roof of the Schneider Medical Center in St. Thomas. As a result, efforts were underway on Thursday to evacuate patients to St. Croix by helicopter. Fortunately, there are no reported deaths. From what we understand, the St. Thomas Airport also sustained damage from rough seas. This is expected to negatively affect recovery efforts. News reports further indicate that besides fallen trees and power outages, St. Croix has sustained far less damage. You are watching Channel 5 News. Stay tuned for more after the break. Welcome back. Dominica's largest public sector trade union believes its fellow trade unions need to get on with the long-standing matter of forming a trade union congress. The Trade Union Congress, or TUC, would serve as an umbrella body for unions on the island. The Waterfront and Allied Workers Union, WAWU, and the Dominica Association of Teachers have recently stated that they are interested in forming a trade union congress. General Secretary of the Dominica Public Service Union, Thomas Latar, told a press conference on Wednesday that the union he represents is ready and willing to play its part in the formation of a TUC.
I can speak for the Dominica Public Service Union, and I can say to you that if tomorrow, God's willing, at least two other unions would say to us, we are prepared to form the Trade Union Congress, we would be on board. I believe, and I must say at this point, that I believe the Dominica Public Service Union is more interested in the formation or establishment of a trade union congress than any of the other unions. Without calling names, I think if you were interested, at least there are three unions, the PSU and two other unions, that could form that congress, and the others would follow.
He says his union continues to appeal to fellow unions on the matter.
And we are concerned, and the Dominica Public Service Union is saying, it is a big shame that in 2017, we do not have a trade union congress. Our position is, if you are interested in something and people are not coming on board, leave them behind and go ahead and form it. And I am blaming my fellow trade unionists for not taking that call seriously.
In other developments, the inclement weather affecting the region has not only caused a disruption to school and work here, but also to local government proceedings. The passage of Hurricane Irma and impending passage of Hurricane Jose has forced the local government department to restructure the process of village council inauguration ceremonies scheduled for this week. During an interview with Channel 5 News, local government commissioner John Fontaine explained that some council inauguration ceremonies scheduled for this week will have to change their format as a result of the inclement weather.
We were supposed to have inauguration of the Dalis La Roche Village Council yesterday. But because of the impending weather and the impact of Irma and also Castlebruce tomorrow, Friday, because of the impending hurricane too, that we're going to have to do alternative arrangements for both. That includes having the councillors take their oath in the presence of the Justice of the Peace and maybe a few community members. So the glamorous speeches and that will not be done in that case.
Fontaine went on to expound on why it is important to have the inauguration ceremonies this week despite the weather forecast.
You have a process of nominations where people present themselves to be elected to serve in the communities. If, in the case of the village council, the membership is 8. Now, if election is held today, which is the 6th of September, inauguration is held within a month or before the 6th of October. So basically, that's what. So in the case of Castlebruce, if we do not have the inauguration on Castle Bishop Dales. One of them, the expiry date is the ninth. If we do not have the inauguration before that time, we have to go back to the polls. So that's why we have to do this thing.
The inauguration of the Grand Bay Village Council is scheduled for Monday, 11th September at the Community Center from 4 p.m. And Dominicans have been cautioned not to lose momentum in their preparedness level ahead of Hurricane Jose. The words from disaster risk consultant with the Office of Disaster Management, Cecil Shillingford. Speaking to Channel 5 News on Thursday morning, Shillingford said that earlier this week, Dominicans weathered the outer bands of Hurricane Irma well and should remain prepared for the effects of Hurricane Jose.
As it gets closer to us, obviously, our preparedness activities will heighten. And it should be in our area late Friday into Saturday, so not much time, as you can see. But we are happy that Dominicans are already in a preparedness mode. So what we would like to say to them is don't drop your guard. You've done well so far, so let us keep the momentum going. We are being told that it will be a Category 3, which will be a major hurricane. So it will be a Category 3 when it gets close to Dominica. We have survived the Irma onslaught. We just like to call on Dominicans to remain alert and follow the guide of the Office of Disaster Management and a lot of the information and the instructions that we are putting out there.
The consultant says several countries have been placed under watches, and while none is yet in effect for Dominica, the country must remain vigilant.
Tiga Barbuda is now on a hurricane watch, and all the other islands north are on tropical storm watch. Dominica is not yet on any watch or warning because the storm is still a little away from us, and the indications right now is that it's not going to go over us. But if it gets dangerously close to us, we will be put on some kind of an alert. The thing with Jose right now, it is staying out at sea in the Atlantic and will skirt around the Leeward Islands. That is at least the projection right now, and go back to sea.
Shillingford also sent out a special warning to fishermen to desist from going out to sea until after Hurricane Jose has passed the area. That's news. Your sports highlights next with Kenny Williams.
First up in sports, England trailed by 77 runs with 6 wickets to spare on day 1 of the third test against West Indies on Thursday. The day's play saw 14 wickets down as West Indies fought back the English side in pursuit of a first series win in England since 1988. Batting first, the visiting side was bowled out for 123 in 57.3 overs. Kyron Powell offered the most resistance to the English bowling attack with 39, while Shai Hope came in with 29. Ben Stokes was a nag to the West Indies batsmen, taking 6 wickets for 22 runs. In reply, England reached 46 for the loss of 6 wickets to end the first day's play. Dee Mallon and Ben Stokes were undefeated on 13 not out each. Jason Holder picked up 2 wickets for 18 runs and Kemar Roach 2 for 21. On the football scene, as of last weekend games, Promex Haarlem United and Northern Concrete and Steel Bombers have gone undefeated in the 2017 Flow Premier League with 2 wins from 2 matches. Bombers' Erskine Williams is the leading goal scorer in the league so far with 6 goals. Now, while the bulk of Bombers' goals have been coming from Williams, Haarlem's have been shared among Randolph Peltier, Eustace Marshall, Idoni Samuel, Errol Blaise, Marcel Germain and Donan Gervray. Looking forward to the weekend, will Bombers be able to maintain their good run when they come up against Sagico Southeast this Saturday on home turf? Well, we'll have to wait and see. Sagico Southeast's Joseph Prince is not far behind Bombers' leading scorer, Erskine Williams, who has the second highest goals so far with 4. Sagico has 1 win and a draw. And of course, Haarlem will also be looking to stay ahead in their match against Sagico Southeast on Sunday who has one win and a loss. Back with more cricket, in a rematch of the 2016 CPL final, Guyana Amazon Warriors exacted revenge behind Rashid Khan's hat-trick and Luke Ronchi's 70 off 33 balls to knock out the defending champion Jamaica Talawas at Brian Lara Stadium on Wednesday. Batting first, Jamaica scored 168 for the loss of 8 wickets. Kumar Sangakkara had an undefeated 57 with Lendl Simmons out on 34. Rashid Khan picked up 3 wickets for 32 runs for Guyana. Set 169 for victory, the winning side equaled the target with 2.1 overs to spare. Luke Ronchi came in with 70 and Chadwick Walton 39. Guyana won by 5 wickets with 13 balls remaining. With this win, Warriors will get a chance to secure a spot in the final at the second qualifier. The winner of that match will go head-to-head with St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots for a chance at lifting the 2017 Caribbean Premier League trophy at the Brian Lara Stadium. In related sports, Australia won the second test against Bangladesh by 7 wickets to level the series 1-1 on Thursday. Nathan Lyon's 13-wicket haul helped propel Australia to the win, along with a well-deserved 123 from David Warner. The final scores from that encounter: Bangladesh 305 and 157 all out, Australia 377 and 87 for 3 in 15.3 overs. That's all the sports for now. I am Kenny Williams. Join us next time.
It's now time for the weather forecast.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's weather broadcast. I'm your presenter, Annie Carreta Joseph. We begin this evening by taking a look at earlier infrared satellite imagery, which showed Hurricane Irma over the northern portion of the Caribbean continue along a west-northwest track. Out in the Atlantic is Hurricane Jose. At 5 p.m., Jose intensified into a Category 3 hurricane near latitude 15.5 degrees north, or about 590 miles east of Dominica. Entries in Dominica are advised to monitor the progress of Hurricane Jose and to make all necessary preparations as the system continues to move west-northwest closer to the Leeward Islands. The concern for Dominica at this time is possibly impacts from feeder bands. Current projection is for an increase in thunderstorm, cloudiness, showers, moderate to heavy at times with gusty winds by Friday afternoon, particularly on Saturday. A flood watch or warning may be issued for the island by tomorrow, Friday. Persons in areas prone to flooding, landslides, and fallen rocks, you are advised to continue to exercise caution. Let's take a look at conditions for the afternoon. Cloudy skies associated with lingering moisture from Irma affected the island, resulting in mostly cloudy skies. Radar imagery indicated shower and thunderstorm activity over Dominica during the afternoon. Conditions for tonight, mostly cloudy skies with showers and possible thunderstorm activity, and tomorrow, increasingly cloudy skies with showers and possible thunderstorm activity by afternoon. Sea conditions, moderate to rough in open water with waves up to 12 feet, small craft operators and sea bathers, especially on the north and eastern coast, you are advised to continue to exercise extreme caution. Let's take a look at conditions for the weekend. Again, tomorrow, Friday, increasingly cloudy skies with showers and thunderstorm activity by afternoon. On Saturday, cloudy to overcast skies with showers and thunderstorm activity associated with Hurricane Jose. And on Sunday, mostly cloudy skies with showers and possible thunderstorm activity. Across the region tomorrow, partly cloudy to cloudy skies with showers and possible thunderstorm activity. On the international scene, partly cloudy skies in New York, some possible thunderstorm activity in Miami and Caracas, cloudy skies with rain in London, and partly cloudy skies in Beijing. The sun will rise tomorrow at 5:53 a.m. and set at 6:12 p.m. For up-to-date information, log on to our website at weather.gov.dm or call the weather hotline at 447-5555. Please remember that we are in the hurricane season. Please keep updated. Thank you and good night.
To end the news, the headlines again. Local ham radio operators link Dominicans with their loved ones in the aftermath of Hurricane Irma. Dominicans warned not to let their guards down with Hurricane Jose continuing to strengthen in the Atlantic. And the DPSU leadership tells fellow trade unions to stop dragging their feet on forming a trade union congress. Feel free to contact us at news@marpin2k4.com. You can also access our past newscasts on our YouTube channel. On behalf of the entire production team, I am Andrea Louis, and to all of our viewers around the world, thank you so much for watching. Join us next time.